don't do. You can't be done. And I just dare you to own that statement. Because it puts it all on God. It puts it all on Him. Lord, if you don't do it, it just can't be done. Yes. Lord, we thank you. Hey, Lord, thank you. What a word. I'm okay with being a remnant. I don't know about y'all, but I'm good with being a remnant. I'm good with that. I don't gotta be first. I just want to be in the number. I just want to be in the number. We're going to go up again.
Let's go.
We're going to go up again. Because the fire is started. All right? Fire has started. And I like being close by the fire. Amen. Prophetess Paula Ware is about to approach.
Shepherds of Ohig, hallelujah. Prophetess Keisha Reeves, I salute you. All leaders, ministers of the faith, family, and friends.
Woo!
Just to take it all in. You know, just to soak in this glorious presence. I don't know about you, but it's His presence for me. Hallelujah.
Thank you for your presence.
Well, before I minister, I want to just say we are in the Spirit. I believe that you ministered half my message, and then Danielle came and took another part of it. Amen. But I want to give a special shout out to all the minor prophets with a major word. Did you hear what I said? See, because in the Bible, someone has divided the major prophets from the minor prophets. But I want to thank Minister Pam, because she said to me, she referred to me several names, and she said to me, they may not be popular, but they keep a word in their head. Amen. Some might call us minor prophets. Hallelujah. But we have a major word of God in our belly. Glory to God. My report, hallelujah, today is titled The Remnant. It's a Jesus thing. So, as it has been established by the title of this gathering, I'm here to report out to the remnant soldiers in the army of the Lord.
Come on.
All right, as they say in the army. at ease, soldiers. Okay. Get comfortable. Get rest in the Lord. Amen. Amen. My report is established to refresh and renew your recollection of your responsibility as it relates to regime, rank, regimen, recourse, and restitution for us, God's chosen vessels. Now there's a cry that they release in the army. Let me hear you shout, Remnant.
Remnant.
It's a Jesus thing.
It's a Jesus thing.
Oh, come on, say it like you mean it.
The remnant.
It's a Jesus thing.
It's a Jesus thing.
All right, I'm going to give you the military explanation of these five topics I mentioned. Regime means an authoritarian government, also means authority, rule, reign, dominion. The Godhead is the source. Rank means a position in the hierarchy of the armed forces. God chose you and your position. Regimen, a prescribed way of life. It's established by God in heaven before you were knitted in your mother's womb. Recourse, a source of help in a difficult situation. God set it up so we don't stand alone. And restitution, the restoration of something lost or stolen to its proper owner. Amen. God has an established time for you to plunder the goods the enemy stole from you. Hallelujah. So my report is based on heaven's message in Ephesians 6, starting with verse 10 through 18. I'll be reading from the King James Version. Very familiar. Pastor Chica and the praise team already ushered us in with the battle cry. Amen. So verse 10 says, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord. I need to say that again because somebody needs to catch it. Be strong in the Lord. He didn't say yourself. And in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. That ye may be able to what?
He said stand.
Against the wiles of the devil. Are you catching the strategies? Verse 12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Who in here has fought in the world before? We weren't wrestling with flesh and blood, though. But when we know better, we do better. So this word is telling me I don't have to fight. I don't have to whoop you no more.
I don't have to take you
to the street no more. I don't have to take my earrings off. I don't have to do that. He said, but against principalities,
come on.
Against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. What world?
This world.
Where are we?
This world.
Okay. All right. You with me. Against spiritual wickedness in high places. Oh, God.
Come on.
13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand in the evil day. And having done all, to sit down.
To stand. To stand.
Fall down.
Stand.
Okay, just check. Run away.
Stand.
14 says, stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with what lies?
True.
Who is the truth?
Jesus.
So what's your source?
Jesus.
Okay. Not the lies that Shelly and Karen was talking about. Not that. Okay.
True.
And having on the breastplate of self-righteousness. That's not what he said. Well, where we get our righteousness from?
From God.
From God.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So that means when I get puffed up and hot, because
uh-huh.
you're bumping your gums, you're talking about me, like, oh, yeah. Face, oh, face. But my flesh is, oh, yeah, I'm here.
What you
want to
do?
What's whatever.
Y'all know what has happened. And if you didn't do it, you thought about it. And then I was the one thinking about it because I don't know how to fight. I could talk a good game, no. Don't let the smooth taste fool you.
That's all it
takes. I'm gonna be one of them from you.
Because I know I have people I can call. Verse 15 says, and your feet shod with the preparation.
Yes, yes.
Preparation. Preparation
uh-huh.
of
uh-huh.
what?
The gospel
of peace.
Uh-huh.
Ooh, what does he say about the peacemakers?
Yeah.
They are sons of God. Yeah. He calls yeah. them sons of God. Ooh, yes. There have been some times.
Come on.
Verse 16 says, above all, taking the shield of
uh-huh.
faith.
Uh-huh.
The shield of fear.
Faith.
We're gonna circle back around, so I need to just follow the Lord. Wherewith ye shall be able to quench
uh-huh.
yes, ma'am.
All the fiery darts of the wicked.
Yeah.
17 says, and take the helmet of salvation.
Uh-huh.
Is salvation important?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Put it on.
Yeah.
And the sword of the Spirit,
put it on.
Which is the word of God.
Yes.
18 reminds us, praying always with prayer and supplication
uh-huh.
in the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
And watching.
Yeah.
Watching. Hallelujah. Thereunto with all perseverance
uh-huh.
and supplication
uh-huh.
for all saints. Not
yeah.
just me.
Yeah.
All. Okay, so today I'm going to address some very important points in Ephesians 6 to help us understand what we where we stand, and then I will make a connection to Ephesians as reported
Amen.
In the book of Daniel.
Come on, yeah.
All right.
Chapters 1 and 2.
Come on.
All right.
Anybody tapped into Daniel?
Come on.
All right, so I want you to remember Ephesians 6,
yeah.
10 through 18.
Uh-huh.
Remember the instructions God gave us to war,
mm-hmm.
to battle. I also want to throw this scripture in. This is my go-to. It's short and sweet. I'm good with double numbers, all that kind of stuff. So this won't work for me. Exodus 14 and 14 says, Jesus will fight your battle for you. There's more. He says, all you have to do,
come on,
we is be at peace.
Come on.
Think about what instructions we've been given. Glory to God. So Ephesians is telling us that when we put on our full armor, keep your sword handy, right? It's the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Not the one you might have under your mattress in case somebody come in your house.
Knocked out.
The one that is filled with truth.
Yeah.
Come on.
We battle by standing.
Come on.
You don't have to move.
Help us.
You came here and you said you get that posture.
Yeah.
Imagine a shield of faith that covers from head to toe.
Come on, the whole thing.
The whole thing.
Yes.
Head to toe.
Just
your side. Perfect for you.
Help.
It is a shield of what?
Faith.
Not fear.
Not fear.
So if you are warring against a particular issue or challenge.
Come on here, Paula.
Afraid.
Come on.
My God.
You don't even have a shield.
Oh, you know?
Yeah.
You just
yeah.
told me.
Yeah.
My God.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah.
It's a shield of faith.
Yeah.
See, come on, Holy Spirit.
That's it.
the challenge we may have is that we want to do it in our strength.
Come on, come on.
Because we know us. Yeah. You know yourself.
Yeah, I can do it. Come on.
But can
come
I tell you something?
Come on, help us, help us.
You don't trust God because you don't know us.
Yeah, that's it.
Know him is to trust him. And how do you get to know him? It's in the sword, not the one under your mattress. Well, maybe that is where your Bible is. Pull it out, pull your sword out. If you don't read about him, you won't know him. And if you do know him without reading about him, you want somebody else's strength. I'm just saying. I'm speaking from
experience.
I'm just saying, if it's God we need to know him is to read his word. And I stand on his word. So when I go to battle, I might even be a little cocky, but I'm not going to say it because I know my daddy. And I have faith in my daddy. So when the fiery darts are coming to me, baby, I'm just standing. Because guess what? You can't touch this. Because my faith has been solidified in my relationship with my Father, who says all I have to do is stand. Can I tell you something else? Some of us are so burdened and so heavy because you're fighting without faith. You're fighting without a shield of faith. It's a faith walk. And it has to do with trust. Pride will come in because we trust ourselves.
That's true. That's good.
But you know, and when you say yes to God and you surrender, oh, send me God, I'll go. You may not understand what you're saying. You mean it. However, you mean the conditional aspect of it. Oh, no, not my child, God. No, I didn't mean that part. Oh, God, please, Lord Jesus, save my... You're begging because you did not stand. Your faith has wavered.
Come on, help us today.
What is faith? It's what you believe.
Come on.
You don't believe in yourself, and you don't believe in God. So when it gets really heavy... as he allows it to, he's testing us.
That's right. That's right. Come on.
It's a trial and a tribulation. And you ought to be shouting and dancing and praising and worshiping God because he says in his word, count it all joy. How in the world, Lord, do I count it all joy when my family is dysfunctional? Surely you didn't mean that. Count that all joy. Oh, yes, he did. God is a liar. He meant that.
That's right. That's right.
Count it all joy because you have been chosen. Count it all joy because he trusts you with the battle. Count it all joy that I know my daddy is never going to leave me or forsake me, so I shall stand. And behind that shield of faith, I'm laughing at you, devil, because you don't have me anymore. My daddy got me.
Come on,
Will. That's good.
You're carrying burdens that God didn't assign you to carry.
All right.
Because you don't know him.
All right.
Because you don't trust him. We just gonna keep it real.
This
guy gave
us,
it to me and chastised me, so I'm just
help
sharing.
Us.
I'm just a messenger today. Amen.
Come on.
And when you get to this position and posture of standing because you have read about your Father, you understand he is who he is and he shall not lie. You know that he'll never leave you nor forsake you, even in the midst of your trials and tribulations. Because you used to do things a certain way, you haven't shaken yourself off of yourself. And you're still whining and complaining and crying and moaning and groaning because you don't know your Father. There's nothing in this word that I have read that says God will fail. I dare you to test me. Test me on it. Show me the scripture where it says he will fail. fair. It's not fair. You are relying on a recycled word that you heard from somebody else. You're fighting like those you watch and you aspire to be. Your battle is for you.
Come on.
So let's talk about the application of the word. In Daniel chapter 1, Daniel and some other young, good looking men, wise, have knowledge, understanding. Nebuchadnezzar, who was king in Babylon, what we call Babylon today, besieged the city of Judah. Do you know what Judah means?
Praise.
Praise. The city of Judah is a city of praise. So today I want to decree and declare that you are like the city of Judah. Praise is a weapon. Am I right? Worship. Weapon of mass destruction. We're going to tear something up with some worship, all right? So what I'm saying to you is this.
Yes, Lord.
Daniel lived in Judah. Daniel was praise.
Yeah.
You become your environment.
That's right.
What kind of environment is at your house?
My God. Oh, God. Listen.
I'm not judging. I'm speaking from the spirit.
You're helping us today.
What's the name of the city where you live? Can I help y'all? I live in Humble, Texas.
Come on.
Yeah, okay. Humble, Texas. I hear you.
God moved me from the hood.
Come on.
To Humble, Texas.
Yeah.
I love the hood.
Yeah.
I love all things about the hood. I represented the church. I was all in the trap. In all parts of the trap. But God said through the prophet, the Lord said, Sister Ware, get some boxes. Start packing. God is getting ready to give you a house. This is 2017.
My God.
He's like, well, we ain't got no money. He must need somebody else. No. I didn't say it out loud, but that's what I was thinking. Okay. And then I remembered, the prophet said.
Yes.
He's a messenger from God. Okay. All right. Now, I'm going to tell my husband this.
Yeah.
Okay, we ain't gonna worry about that part right now. Right. I went to get the boxes. And so I'm looking real crazy around the house packing things.
Amen.
But God said, get the boxes and start packing. You know what that's called? Activating your faith. And now I know that means God was testing my faith. Just because it doesn't look like the end result. Your faith, which is also a shield, will carry you to meet God's plan.
Come on, girl. You're preaching, Paula.
That's good.
So here we are back to Daniel, who lives in the city of praise. He has been besieged. The city has been just a mess because Nebuchadnezzar and his men, also the Chaldeans, who are robbers, by the way, they also robbed Job. So they are also in Babylon and they go get certain people. Specifically in Daniel's case, Daniel and the Hebrew boys, they had to look a certain way.
Yeah.
He said they had to be good looking.
Well,
I didn't understand that part, but it doesn't matter. He had a plan.
Right?
Nebuchadnezzar even had a plan. So he brings Daniel in, and can I tell you about Daniel, who was challenged, but he didn't look like it.
Yeah.
See, sometimes we wear our battle on our face.
Come on,
people know what you're going through because you look a certain way. Right? You stop dressing how you usually dress. You stop talking how you usually talk. You have consumed yourself in fear and anguish and worry and doubt and anxiety and depression and oppression and rejection and bitterness and rage and wrath. It's on your face.
Yeah.
It's on your clothes. And see, Daniel at one point even began to wear sackcloth.
Uh-huh.
Okay, well, that's a statement of I'm grieving, I'm mourning. I want to say to you today, put that sackcloth back in the garbage. Put on your garment of praise. Amen. Stop wearing your trials and tribulations on your face. You should be wearing joy. That's what he's saying.
Put joy on.
That will help you to remember who your daddy is.
Amen.
And guess what? The Holy Spirit told me that as the light of Jesus Christ, fear dims your light. People don't see Jesus in you.
That's good.
They know what you're going through. Put on faith and joy. Right? That's what he tells us to do. He knows what he's talking about. We just have to remember that. So Daniel goes with these three Hebrew boys, and Daniel is persistent to obey God. Period. He is sold out. Right? We say that. We say these things casually, but we really don't mean we go home and cry.
Come on.
And tremble.
Come on.
Right? And face the reality of what we're challenged by. But can I tell you, by example of Daniel, if you take on the posture and position of faith, which means you believe what you know, that those things that come toward you, when it doesn't sound right, when you discern in your shamana, something's just not right. That's not of God. You know what Daniel did? As the king presented to them what they would be doing, he gave them some great plans that they were going to be in charge of some things. And that meant that they had to be trained.
All right.
So in this training, they would eat what the king provided in portion. Okay. Yes. Daniel, being the obedient servant of God as he was, said, I'm not eating that.
Yeah.
That will defile my body. Now, let's think about this. Your city has been besieged by a king of a different god. Oh, you're so bold? You're not going to do what he said? That's right. This is my words. That's my paraphrase. But Daniel said to the man in charge of Daniel and the Hebrew boys and the eunuchs, he said,
come on.
I'm not going to eat that.
Come on.
But here's why. It's going to defile me. And that goes against my God. And so,
come on.
I'm going to challenge you
in
your king's portions.
Come on.
Because you're training us. But I guarantee you in 10 days, if you allow me to eat vegetables and drink water, I will be stronger than all of your need. I will be wiser. I will have knowledge. I will have wisdom. I will have dreams and visions, and I will be able to interpret them. He did not buckle because he knows his daddy. He trusts the God that he called his God. King of kings. Lord of lords. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He believed, I'm going to speak what the Holy Spirit tells me to speak, and I'm standing.
That's it.
And he stood. And guess what? The man in charge of all of them, he said, now listen, you might mess something up for me. I'm not going to take, you're not going to eat with them, sir. That's it, it's final. He stood his ground. And guess what? They approved it. And guess what else? He petitioned God. He prayed to God in request. Because that's who we lean on. Right? We go to God. And we allow God to see that, oh, my son is going to obey. He's not going to take them out to the street and whoop them. Right? He's not digging a tunnel at night trying to escape. No, he withstood being a hostage.
Yes.
Now I want you to go back to what's happening in the world today. What's happening in Israel?
Mm-hmm. Come on here.
Right?
Come on here.
You spoke about Isaiah.
Come on here.
What does Isaiah talk
Come
about?
Come on here.
Yeah. Daniel is going to talk about the exact same thing.
Yes.
Amen. So this is why we need to get in the Word. Because these prophecies are coming to
they
pass.
They are. Yes. They are. Sis.
Right? And we get fearful because we don't know the Word.
Because we don't know the Word.
Yeah. Amen. So Daniel prayed and asked God to give him those things that he stood boldly to say he would have. Just 10 days. All I need is 10 days. 10 is a number of perfection.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Amen.
Amen.
He said he would be stronger, wiser, more knowledgeable, have understanding, dreams and visions, and interpretation. And God did it.
Yeah.
Because he was obedient. And guess what? The other side said that Daniel and his boys were 10 times stronger than those who sat before the king and ate with him. You see 10 again?
Come on.
Okay. So here we are. Let's jump over to chapter 2. Mm-hmm. King Nebuchadnezzar, they are in a city. The city is called Shinar.
All right.
Guess what Shinar means? The watch of him who sleeps.
Okay.
So guess what God does? He puts Nebuchadnezzar to sleep.
Uh-huh.
Nebuchadnezzar has dreams. He's puzzled and he's afraid.
Yeah.
So in his camp where they practice the occult, he called on the witch folk.
Yeah.
Go get the magicians. Go get the sorcerers. I have a dream I need interpreted. The other piece is that he didn't remember the dream, but it startled him. So they bring these folk in, and they consider these people to be wise. Go figure.
Yeah.
They couldn't do it. They tried to buy time. Well, king, live forever. Please just tell us a little bit something about your dream, and we'll give you an interpretation. And Nebuchadnezzar said, you're lying. You don't know, but you're buying time.
Mm-hmm.
See, Nebuchadnezzar had gifts, but he was serving the wrong God. Nebuchadnezzar said to them, give me the dream and the interpretation, or you will all be slain.
All right.
They couldn't do it. So he makes a decree. What do we know about a decree? It's established.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
It is so. Daniel was a wise man.
Yeah.
So the decree went out to include Daniel. Go slay all the wise men. Since nobody can tell me my dream, slay them all. Write it down. Make it a decree. Word gets back to Daniel, and Daniel says, okay, that's a little hasty.
Right.
What is that about?
Right.
Tell him, give me some time.
Uh-huh.
By the next day, I will tell him what he dreamed, and I will give him the interpretation.
Yes.
Through God. Okay, so he gets that time. The next day, Daniel comes in because he has prayed to God. He's praised him. He's worshiped. And he petitioned God what he needed so that not only would he not be slain, but he asked for the wise men of the occult not to be slain as well.
Mm.
What kind of love is that?
Come on here.
My God.
Right?
Wow.
Like that person at your job you can't stand.
Come on.
Grace.
Maybe you were there just for that person.
Because
you're the light.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, maybe your light is dim because you're afraid. Mm-hmm. And you don't know God. You don't trust him. Just a thought. So Daniel goes before the king. He tells him every detail. He says even the secrets of the dream and the interpretation, which has to do with end time. So I want to encourage you to go read that. But here's what I gathered from that as I went back to Ephesians. Daniel could have buckled. Right. He's in Babylon. Y'all know what we know about Babylon.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot going on. He could have buckled. He could have yielded to King Nebuchadnezzar because he said so. But what Daniel did was walk around with his full armor on.
Yeah.
Couldn't see it. Physically.
Yeah.
But spiritually, he was confident.
Right.
He boasted on his God.
Yeah.
right? He stood on the principles of what God told us about himself. So we're battling these wars and these battles, and we're fighting, and we're not sleeping, we're not eating, we can't think straight, we go to work, just shut the door. I used to close the door and cry for 8 hours, clean up real good, put on that imposter mask, uh-huh. and go out yeah. and say, hey, y'all have uh-huh. a good evening, get to my car and uh-huh. cry the entire way home, yeah. go to bed, put the covers over my head, yeah. wake up with tears yeah, in my yeah, eyes. Yeah, why? Because I didn't know my God. I'm weak.
Yeah.
I'm unreliable. Right. Sometimes I'm not even trustworthy.
Come on here.
I'm afraid.
Yeah.
I'm lonely.
Yeah.
I'm scared.
Yeah.
In my own strength.
Yeah.
But there's something about knowing that for someone who doesn't fight well, all I have to do is put on this spiritual
arm
and stand.
Yeah.
If I can get my faith posture uh-huh. in the place it should be, and remain in the position
yes.
of standing.
Yes.
Just envision.
Yes.
He has provided a shield
yes.
of faith.
My God.
Your faith
here.
Might be right here, so maybe that's as high as your shield
Come
is.
Come on here, help us, help us, help us.
Or maybe, it,
yes.
you know, some days it's up here, but most
help
days
us.
It's down here.
Help us.
Your faith is built on truth.
Yes.
Amen. And so I want to encourage you today, Sister Keisha, prophetess. I have to obey the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
This vision would not lift from me. So with your permission, I would like to be able to move forward for the minor of prophets today. Amen. Apostle Paul highlights the remnant in Romans 11, emphasizing the faithful few who remain true to the covenant despite the unfaithfulness of many. Mm-hmm. Have you remained faithful to the call and covenant of the Lord on your life despite circumstances and burdens? Please come forward so we can provide recourse through prayer and the love of Jesus Christ. Is it you? Despite being brokenhearted, despite the lack in your life, despite depression, despite sickness and disease, despite financial barrenness, despite the recurring cycles of having to fight for what is yours, despite not having a job, despite the battles in your marriage, despite your children going astray, despite your friends who are really your enemies in disguise, despite the broken relationship that's really hardship, despite fear, despite anxiety, despite not feeling love, despite not loving yourself, despite not being able to get ahead, despite, if it ain't one thing, it's another. I want to invite you to come forward. And those who remain, I want to ask you to pray. Praise and worship our Father in heaven, who is the head of his army in the earth. We praise God for his love that heals and delivers. Hallelujah. Amen. So I want to invite you to come forward if that's you. If it's not you, let's keep praising and worshiping
Amen.
God.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And I want to use one of my weapons of warfare. And if you all are led, if you come and stand with our sisters and brothers as they come forward, I'm going to release a flag of sanctification.
Amen. Yes.
And I'm going to release it over you. Amen.
Thank you. Come on, come over your mouth and give God praise.
down. We're getting ready to have the Righteous Cry Dance Ministry come up. But I want to say this real quick. Somebody's watching you. Somebody's watching you, and they're looking to see how you're going to stand. And if you declare yourself to be a worshiper, if you declare yourself to be a lover of God, when trials and tribulations hit your life, they're looking to see how you're going to stand. Because somebody said it earlier, oh, I thought she was a... Somebody's watching to see how you're going to stand. You better stand like you know God. Come on here, Righteous Cry Dance. Y'all ready?
No more.